So our purpose at Health Jankari is to ensure good health for one and all. And to achieve good health, we need better information. And thus, we have this Health Jankari sessions that are being held every Sunday. So we discuss various topics that are generally taboos or not discussed in our society. Today, we have one such topic, and we are very privileged to have Dr. Medha with us. We would be discussing about women's health and reproductive health today. You please feel free to ask any question on the live chat, and we will be taking them up towards the end of the session. Thank you. Just a second. I would like to hand over the session to Sumiran for a bit to introduce everyone towards health Jankari and COVID Jankari. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. So we started COVID Jankari with the sole intention of to provide validated information and resources to those people in distress during the pandemic. State-wise communities have over 50,000 people assisting each another, backed by 250 digital volunteers to manage them efficiently. To better organize these volumes, we have now built a tech-led crowdsource matching platform. And we have also tied up with a pool of doctors to provide teleconsultation at a subsidized rate to our communities so that they can avoid self-medication. We've also tied up with Zomato Feed in India initiative to provide foods to street dwellers and street animals during the lockdown across various cities in India. And we have now started our next flagship of events known as Health Jankari, where in each Sunday we invite a doctor to talk about events. So welcome, Dr. Medha, and thank you for joining us today. So today's topic is regarding good practices of reproductive and sexual health in women. So I give the control to Dr. Medha. Please introduce yourself.
Hi, good morning. I'm Dr. Medha. I'm doing my residency at Osmania Medical College. Please feel free to ask anything. Don't hesitate. I'm here to answer your questions.
Thank you. Thank you for being so welcoming. We'll start with some agenda that we have prepared. And meanwhile, the audience can put their questions on the chat. Thank you. So, Dr. Medha, my first question about you is about a very interesting topic, PCOD. What is PCOD?
Okay. Firstly, PCOD is a outdated term. What we call that now is it's called polycystic ovarian syndrome. There are multiple criteria in this syndrome. It's called a syndrome because there are multiple things that happens to women who are affected by it. You won't believe it if I tell you there are at least 3 million women in India itself who suffer from this problem. So we take hormonal criteria, biochemical criteria, clinical criteria, and ultrasound. What happens is there is in your ovary, there are multiple follicles that are formed. Okay. So when this happens, usually in a normal woman, before we menstruate, the ovum is released. And over a period of time, if it is not fertilized, then she menstruates. It just gets expelled out of the body. In a woman with PCOS, because of multiple follicles, ovum is not released at all. There are anovulatory cycles. That is why they're not fertile. That is why they find it very difficult to conceive, because the ovary does not release the ovum itself into the uterus. Okay, and they have very high testosterone levels. Their hormonal profile is completely deranged. They have high testosterone and very high estrogen levels. So because of that, they get this acne, hirsutism, male pattern of baldness. Also, it leads to weight gain. They also have, they're also not very sensitive to insulin receptors. So it results in insulin resistance. That's why there is weight gain in the body. So, you can imagine a very young girl who is supposed to look pretty in front of the society, and she has acne, hair fall, and, she gains weight. It affects them mentally a lot. I have seen a lot of such patients who, it really affects them. So, yeah, that is about PCOS. And there are multiple methods of treatment. First thing that a gynecologist always encourages their patient is to lose weight. It is very easy for me to, tell someone to just lose weight. Okay, go exercise, go lose weight. But it is not as easy as it is said. So, you know, what you should do is anything. It could be anything. Your regular exercise, your regular workouts. If you like to dance, you can dance. If you like to, you know, go jogging, walking, swimming, cycling, you can do whatever you're comfortable with. Try to lose weight. Okay. And have a healthy lifestyle. Eat good food. You can, you know, eat junk. It's not like you have to completely avoid, remove junk from your diet. You can eat it, but always see what you're eating. You shouldn't overdo anything. Try to lose weight, have a healthy lifestyle, have a positive attitude, have a positive mind. I have seen many, many patients who have gotten cured without medication just by changing their lifestyle. If this doesn't help, then we have a lot of hormonal treatments and all that for, you know, patients to overcome this problem. And if PCOS is your main concern of infertility, then there are a lot of medical and surgical methods which they can opt for.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you for answering this question. One thing that happens along with PCOD or PCOS is hair fall. A lot of people have this question, and it was also going in my, you know, college chat and all. COVID along with PCOS was a very bad combination. A lot of girls were saying that, you know, they're about to go bald because of the excessive hair fall they're facing. Is there anything they can do about it?
Yeah. COVID and hair fall, I have also faced it. Okay. So what happens is regularly, like whenever we have hair fall, what happens is whenever our body is under stress, it could be emotional or any stressful period. Like if you're undergoing a surgery, if you have high fever, if you've had any disease, it could be COVID, it could be anything else. So, or any emotional stress, when what happens is our entire body concentrates on fighting the stressful event. Hair fall is not hair growth is not an important thing for the body. So it completely concentrates on fighting the stress, and it does not concentrate on providing nutrients to the hair. That is why we end up having hair fall. Also, hair fall doesn't immediately happen after the stressful event. It happens about 2 to 3 months after you've gotten COVID or a surgery or anything for that matter. So why it takes 2 to 3 months is, regular hair, like when you have new hair follicles growing on your hair, on your scalp, it grows for about 2 to 6 years. Okay, it's called anagen phase. It grows for these many years. When the body is under physical or emotional stress, this period of 2 to 6 years, it is shortened to 2 to 3 months. So they just last 2 to 3 months and then they die. So that is the reason why you have hair fall. You can see hair clogging your drain, or when you're combing, you lose a lot of hair, clumps of hair and all that. So it is bad, but you are what you eat. So just make sure you have a healthy diet and healthy lifestyle. And if you observe this for a period of 6 months, it is okay. It is okay to lose up to 100 to 200 hair per day. And also this can happen up to a period of 6 months after the stressful event. But if it goes beyond 6 months, then please consult your dermatologist. You should get some help.
Thank you, doctor. The other question related to the same topic is, does PCOD or PCOS affect my mental health also?
Definitely it does. Like I said, you're a young girl, a teen, or in your early 20s, you're expected to look good, you're expected to look pretty. There is a dress that they want to fit into, they can't because they're obese. They want to wear some makeup, they can't because of the acne and all that. So, and society expects a lot of things from young girls, right? You should look this way, you should, you know, dress this way and all that. And they can't perform. And also studies have been conducted on women suffering from PCOS, wherein it is said that a woman with PCOS is 3 times more likely to go into depression, to have anxiety issues, and to have bipolar disorders than a normal woman without PCOS. So it is not something bad. It is not, you know, you don't have to feel bad about it. Just accept it and do as much as you can to overcome it. That's it.
Is there a preventive way to avoid falling into this whole trap of
definitely. I mean, given the stress, the thing is, stress is the main precipitating factor, and amount of stress that that kids have these days at school after they attain menarche and all, you know, with studies and with college and all, it is very common. It has become a very common thing. Every other girl suffers from this problem. But from childhood, try to have a very healthy lifestyle. Try to be as stress-free as possible and do what you love. Just do what you love. That's it.
Is there anything parents can do, young girls stay with their parents, right? Mm-hmm. So is there anything their parents, siblings can do to, you know, reduce the stress so that the girl has a healthier mm-hmm. outlook towards life? I mean, stress yeah. As you said, is because of yeah. the society, because they force you to look in a particular way. If that stress is reduced, maybe, you know, the person can look towards, have a more supportive mm-hmm. way of going towards a better lifestyle.
Yeah, definitely. Support starts with family. So those of y'all who are suffering from it, please talk. Don't hesitate to talk about it. It could be to your family members or to a therapist or to a gynecologist, to anybody. Just approach someone. And it is not a permanent thing. There are multiple ways to, there are multiple treatment methods. You can overcome it just by talking about it. Just get some help. That's it.
The next question is regarding the relationship between COVID vaccination and various women issues. So does getting a vaccine affect your menstrual cycle?
No, nothing. You can take the vaccine before your menses, during your menses, after your menses. If you're in the menopausal period, premenopausal, postmenopausal, there are no contraindications. However, I'd like to mention that if someone has been affected by COVID infection, I have seen a lot of people who have been complaining that their cycles are irregular or they're having heavy bleeding or less or no bleeding at all. This could happen. Not, the vaccine has nothing to do with it, but the virus has something to do with it. The thing is, if you're the treatment that they give for COVID and the stress that it gives to your body and the hormone response that happens during COVID, it is very likely to alter the HPO axis. It is very likely to cause a hormonal imbalance also. So it is quite common to have menstrual irregularities. Just observe your cycles for a period of 2 months. Within 2 months, it will regularize. If it does not, then visit your gynec. Just get some help if it does not.
Thank you. I think this clears a lot of doubts. Also, there's a question saying, does vaccination cause early menopause in women?
No, it has got nothing to do with, menstruation, menopause, menarche, nothing. Take the vaccine at the earliest and whichever is easily available to you, just take it. It is pretty safe. It's just like any other vaccine. It is going to save you.
Thank you. Okay. COVID, the anxiety has increased a lot in women, also because of the work from home scenario. So this has also been affecting the women's health. Is there something they can do about it? Because we are confined at our homes and not everyone is allowed to go walk or run. So is there something they can do at home?
Don't overburden yourself with, a lot of work. It's okay to feel this way. It's okay to not do anything. It's okay to not be able to go out. I know it's very frustrating, we have all faced it, but keep yourself busy as much as possible. Try to do things that you love. People who are very into their work, I think this is the best time for them to explore what they like, what they don't like, what they want to do. They can pursue their hobbies and all that. Do a lot of other things. But even if you don't do anything, it's okay. It's pretty okay to feel this way.
Okay. Next question is a very different angle. So we have a lot of products that we use, from pads, tampons, and cups. Is there a difference between them? Is there a particular thing we should use and we should avoid?
Yeah. So this is a very important thing that needs to be discussed right now. Good you brought it up. Sanitary pads, for that matter, please check the content or just what it is made up of. If it is made up of regular cotton without a plastic cover, then that is pretty safe. But if it is covered with a plastic sheet, it is promoted widely because it has very good absorption. So if it has good absorption, it lasts longer, and that is why it is being promoted. But the problem with this is, when it is covered with plastic, it has chances of causing a lot of local reactions. not just that, it can cause rashes and local reactions, but also over a period of years, when you've been using it regularly, it has chances of getting absorbed into your body. And this much, and it produces something known as dioxins. So this interferes with your, it again interferes with your hormones in the body. So it has a very high chances of causing something called endometriosis. It has very high chances of increasing the estrogen. Very high estrogen is bad. So when there is high estrogen, you have chances of, you know, getting endometriosis or endometrial cancer. So please be careful before, check the content, check what your sanitary pad is made up of. Also, coming to menstrual cups, on the other hand, the thing with menstrual cups is it is an inert material, silicone. You can change it once in 12 hours, whereas a sanitary pad, you have to change it every 4 to 6 hours. So you can use it once in 12 hours, and also you have to boil it in water for 5 minutes before, you know, using it for the first time, and then wash it. Wash it whenever you're changing it. But it is an inert material. It does not cause any local, it might cause irritation. It is difficult in the beginning and all that, but it does not cause any local reactions. It does not affect your uterus, cervix, nothing. It does not have any effect on your body. So I think I have cleared your doubt as to which is better.
The next question is how much bleeding is normal? Like, what is the normal amount of bleeding during menstruation? Like, how do you gauge if you're having excessive bleeding, or is it very scanty? Is there a way or something called normal?
It depends on the number of days that you're bleeding for, and how much you're bleeding. Both are important. Suppose you have very little or normal amount of bleeding for a period of more than 8 days, then you need to consult. Also, if you're having heavy bleeding, like if you're changing 7, 8, 9 pads per day, then for a period of 4 to 5 days also, even that is also not good. So it depends on how many days you're bleeding for. Very less than 2 days, more than 8 days is bad. Also, very little if you're changing like one pad a day, that is just half soap, or if you're changing so many per day, even that is bad. So observe yourself.
The next question is, how do we manage pain during periods? We all get these period cramps and all. How do you manage that pain?
Okay, so medically, I think everyone is aware of this tablet called Meftalspas. You can take that. It is very, very common. Literally every other girl suffers from period pains. If you don't, you're very lucky. So otherwise, you can, use hot water bags on your abdomen. You can keep them on your abdomen. And then you can, you know, listen to some music, just relax, just sleep as much as you can. Don't lift heavy weights. Don't do anything that will increase your bleeding or increase your stress. Just relax, eat some good ice cream, watch a movie. And you, if it's too much, if it's unbearable, you can take Meftal. That's it.
Thank you. We come to a different segment of questions. One question is, when to take a pap smear test, and what is it for?
It basically helps you know if there is any infection in the lower part of your cervix, okay, or if the vagina is healthy. After the age of 40, 42, okay, it is better to take a pap smear if it comes normal, and over it should be taken within a gap of 6 months. Suppose you take one now, it should be taken, another one should be taken after 6 months. So if your first pap smear is suggestive of any problem, there are certain high risk women who should be taking a pap smear, women who have multiple sexual partners, women who have family history of uterine or cervical cancers, and women coming from poor socioeconomic status, they don't know much about personal hygiene. So all these high-risk women, they must and should take a pap smear. It is just a two-minute procedure. It is not as painful as it is shown. It's okay. So if your first pap smear is, if the result says that it is indefinite, or, you know, it is suggestive of any unknown pathology, then you have to repeat it. But if two consecutive pap smears are normal, you don't have to repeat it. You can get it repeated after 2 to 5 years.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Amita. The next question is, should I get vaccinated for cervical cancer? Is that safe?
Regarding vaccine for cervical cancer, you can take an informed decision. It basically is for women who start their sexual activity very soon, very early, and also women who are in non-monogamous relationships. Or regular women also can take it. It is helpful, but high-risk people are women are what I mentioned, and also those who, you know, who don't have a good local hygiene, personal hygiene. They must and should take it. So it is important for high-risk women. If you've had family history also of cervical cancer, then those people must and should take it. For others, it is optional. It's your decision. You can take an informed decision.
It's not compulsory.
It's better if you do take. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Then we have a lot of questions regarding pregnant women. So, and also a lot of doubts regarding pregnancy and COVID vaccination. Can pregnant women take a COVID vaccine? And if so, which one is recommended?
Okay. Thankfully, as of 25th June 2021, the government of India has finally, you know, made the vaccine available for pregnant women. So this was a very big thing for all of us. So we could advise them to, you know, go as soon as possible and get a vaccine. The thing is, pregnant women, they're already immunocompromised. So they're prone to infections easier than, you know, than a normal woman. If you have any comorbidities, it is okay. Along with pregnancy, if you're, you know, diabetic, hypertensive, you're more, if you have comorbidities along with pregnancy, you should take the vaccine at the earliest because you're more prone to get the infection. But a normal pregnant woman, coming to which vaccine is should be taken, whichever is available at the earliest, whichever is easily available, closest to you, please go take it. Okay? All of them are pretty safe. There have, and why I would like to tell you why the government of India has changed this. Earlier, they asked pregnant women not to take it. It was not available for them. It was only available. Then they made it available for lactating women. Now, last week, they made it available for all pregnant women. So the thing was, last year, when India was, when the world was affected with COVID, the case fatality rate in India of pregnant women was with COVID-19 infection was 0.7%. That was okay, and you know, that was pretty okay. But this year, just within 6 months from Jan to June, the case fatality rate was among pregnant women was 5.7%. That is a very big number. That you know, losing a mother, a healthy young mother, that is really sad, and that was a very big number for us. So they took this, the ICMR took this as the basis, and you know. And there have not been any evidence of reactions in women who are pregnant and who have taken the vaccine. It is not going to affect your child. In fact, it is good for your child. When you're lactating, the immunity, the antibodies are going to be transferred through the breast milk to your baby. So it's actually good for you. It is good for the baby. So please take it.
Thank you. Can the COVID virus transfer to my fetus? Is the next question related to the previous one.
There have not been studies showing that the virus has been transferred to the fetus. The thing is, COVID infection does have some problems with pregnancy. Like if you contract the infection early in pregnancy, I have seen multiple cases of, you know, spontaneous abortion, stillbirths. A normal woman, a regular woman without any comorbidities, it is very sad to see that, you know, for me to see almost every other week I have seen, she comes with an intrauterine death. A healthy woman, a healthy baby, all of a sudden her baby is no more. It is very sad for me too. It is very sad for all of us to even see such things. So stillbirth is common. I have seen stillbirth and abortions are common, but the baby being affected congenitally, having any anomalies, that is not yet been proved.
The next question is, what kind of nutrition is recommended during pregnancy?
Okay, first of all, I'd like to tell everyone that there is a myth that our mothers and grandmothers tell their pregnant daughters that, you know, okay, now that you're pregnant, you should eat for two. You have to eat double of what you're eating. And, you know, they keep stuffing them with food. Please don't do that. Progesterone increases your gastric reflux. So they have higher chances of vomiting whenever they try to eat a lot. So the first thing is eat as much as you can. Eat what you like. Eat frequently. And your food should be salted to taste. Don't put salt in excess. It should just be salted to taste. Make sure it is iodized salt that you use. And coming to the calorie requirement and all, during lactation, the calorie intake must be high. It is very difficult for every woman to have, you know, a charted intake, like, you know, okay, breakfast I'm going to eat this, lunch I'm definitely going to eat this. For a period of 9 months, it is difficult for anybody to follow. So eat what you like, but make sure that your daily calorie intake is, when you're pregnant, is 175 calories, okay? 175 kilocalories, 175 calories, and when you're lactating, it should be 210 calories. The thing is, and your protein intake during pregnancy and lactation, so it should be 71 grams. So, and your fiber content, like fruits and vegetables that we eat, make sure it comes up to 28 grams. So the thing is, when women try not to take a high calorie diet, or if your calorie content is inadequate in the food that we consume, the proteins in our body, they are broken down to give energy to the mother. What happens is, these proteins are essential for the growth of the baby. The baby literally survives on this. So you'll have a growth restricted baby. So make sure that the food that you take is high in calories, high in proteins. If you're a non-vegetarian, eat chicken, eat fish, eat eggs. If you're a vegetarian, eat dry fruits, eat lots of green leafy vegetables. You can take good amount of carbs. Make sure carbs are available for your body so that your baby can survive on your proteins. And coming to the weight gain, there is no need to, you know, put on a lot of weight, or there is no need to, you know, control your diet so that you don't look fat. Eat as much as you like. And if weight gain, we advise weight gain to patients based on their pre-pregnancy BMI. So they're classified as underweight, normal weight, obese, and, you know, overweight. So if you're underweight, that is if your BMI is less than 18.5, then you can gain up to 12 to 18 kgs. That is okay. If your normal weight, if your BMI is 18.5 to 24.9, then you can gain about 10 to 12 kilos, 10 to 15 also. That is okay. If you're overweight, if your BMI is 25 to 29.9, then you have to gain around 6 to 11 kilos in whole of 9 months. That is okay. Not more than that, not less than that. And if you're obese, that is if your BMI is more than or equal to 30, then you're allowed to gain 4 to 9 kilos in the entire pregnancy. That's it. Also, if your BMI is normal, but if you're carrying twins or triplets or quadruplets, then your intake must be more. You can gain about, you know, 15 to 24 kilos. That is quite okay.
Thank you, doctor, for answering all the questions so patiently. I now have Sumiran, who would be taking up the next few questions and the audience questions. Thank you so much.
Hello, doctor. Someone from the audience said that how common is irritation in the vagina even on non-period days when you do have to visit your doctor?
Okay. Coming to this, it is common. It is quite common. Itching and discharge. Normal vaginal discharge is okay. What I mean by normal vaginal discharge is it is colorless. It is odorless. It is scanty. It's just little in amount. It should not completely soak your inner garments. So that is okay. But, if it causes a lot of itching and redness and local, rashes, and, you know, if it is foul smelling, if you have a foul smelling discharge or something, and if the color is different, if it is greenish, if it is yellowish, if it is curdy white, then please visit your gynec as soon as possible. We'll give you kits based on what infection you have. And also we can, you know, take a local smear. And if there is any infection, if there is any bacterial or any infection, it can be detected and we can treat accordingly.
Thank you, doctor.
So the next thing is, this is a question regarding fibroids in the uterus. Few doctors suggest monitoring its size for growth, and many feel they shrink on their own. How regularly is a checkup recommended here? Also, what are the options if the size remains the same for 2 to 3 years?
The thing is, treatment for fibroids is based on your menstrual age. That is, if you're postmenopausal, if you've completed your family, or post or premenopausal women who has completed her family, who does not want any more children. Okay, so for such women, and if fibroids are causing heavy menstrual bleeding to an extent that it is, you know, she's completely anemic, she's losing a lot of blood, and she's not able to do her day-to-day activities, then she can go for a hysterectomy. Postmenopausal women, this is what we advise. Pre or postmenopausal, this is what we advise them. But if you're young, if you still haven't had children, or if you still want to continue your family, then there are medical management, surgical management. We do something known as myomectomy, wherein just the fibroid is locally removed. So there are multiple treatments. First treatment that we give is medical itself. If it does not hamper your day-to-day activities, if it is small in size, even if it is there for multiple years, if it does not cause menorrhagia, then it is okay. It's quite common.
So doctor, what do you mean by menorrhagia here?
Excessive bleeding, heavy menstrual bleeding.
Okay. Thank you. So it is a bit, next question is a very generic question. What are a few basic things one can do to maintain a good vagina health?
Okay. Shower daily, washing, there is this thing called V-wash that almost every other girl uses, I guess. One thing I would like to say is, okay, when you're taking shower, just clean yourself, but don't use soap inside your vagina. All these soaps and gels and all, they are meant only for your external genitalia. It is not meant for things inside your vagina, because the vagina is acidic. It is made sure that this environment is maintained so that the woman does not contract any infection. The body is very beautifully designed. So when, and the soap that we use, they're alkaline. So when you use them inside the vagina, it changes the pH completely. And that will invite more infections into the vagina. That will again lead to, you know, vaginal infections or like discharge and all that. So shower and using regular soap is okay. But don't use anything inside the vagina. Everything is just meant on the introitus. That's it.
Thank you, doctor. So actually, I have this question, which is like, there are some whitening creams being used by companies to, you know, whiten the vagina. So are they nice or are they good, or should we, like, yeah, is that recommended or not for someone who wants that?
There are multiple things being endorsed, you know, creams and oils and, you know, gels. There are no studies suggesting that this will give you 100% results or anything. It's just that, I mean, I don't think it is necessary. I don't think it is recommended.
So that's what the question is. Is it necessary?
Yeah.
Because a lot of girls, as
you said before, yeah, they are being heavily endorsed. Okay, coming to, since you've mentioned this, you know, women are also affected by stretch marks in pregnancy on their abdomen. They don't like it, and they also have this pigmentation over their noses and, you know, nasal bridge and cheek area. Yeah. And then they have acne. All this is because of you know, hormonal surge. So that causes acne. And if you already have an acne prone skin or a pigmentation prone skin, it increases during pregnancy. You're more prone to have pigmentation, acne over your body, over your face and all, if you already have a skin that is prone to acne and pigmentation. So you don't have to worry that much about it. Since we're talking about this, let me tell you that let me tell you something about skincare. So please stick to your daily morning and night skincare routine. Use a cleanser that has salicylic acid as the content. Use a regular moisturizer and use your sunscreen every day, even if you're at home. In the night, just cleanser and moisturizer is enough. If you've been undergoing any laser treatments or, you know, any chemical peels or anything prior to pregnancy, and then you found out that you're pregnant, you can postpone all these treatments. As long as your skincare is not an emergency, if you're undergoing something that is an emergency, then consult your dermatologist before doing anything about it. But if all these procedures can definitely wait, And you will not believe it if I tell you there are certain deodorants. Using deodorant during pregnancy is also contraindicated because of certain chemicals that it has. Perfume is okay, deodorant is not okay. And coming to facial creams, okay, if the acne is really bothering them, if they don't like it, then they would want a topical treatment at least, no? Don't use any tablets. Vitamin A, retinoids, hydroquinone, please check the content. Don't use anything by yourself. Please consult your dermatologist before going for it. Salicylic acid less than 2%, you can use that. Azelaic acid can be used. You can consult your dermatologist before using these things. But it is pretty okay to have acne, to have pigmentation, to look this way. They will slowly come down. They will slowly come down and you'll look like your you'll get your pre-pregnant face back after the delivery. It's fine. Also, coming to stretch marks, there are hundreds of, you know, creams and oils and these endorsements that people do that, okay, this is going to go if you use this. We have never seen 100% recovery. It's just body fat that is stretching. So there is no complete treatment. No, but if this is really bothering you, then laser is the option. Like after delivery, they can go for laser treatments that can, you know, they can reduce it. They can, it can't be reduced completely, but to some extent it can.
Thank you, doctor. So my aim of asking this question was to just spread the message out there that it should be your choice and not come in the pressure of the society. Thank you, doctor, for this. So the next question is like, nowadays we come across so many cases of hemorrhagic cyst. What can be the reason for this?
There are multiple reasons and most of them are idiopathic. That is, the reason is unknown. As long as basically hemorrhagic cyst is something that occurs in the ovary. It can come as a peduncle, it can be attached to the ovary. As long as this cyst does not burst or it does not increase in size or it does not affect with a girl's menses or it does not cause excruciating abdominal pain that, you know, you're not able to do anything at all, you need to be rushed to the emergency. As long as it does not have such symptoms, it is okay. As long as it is small in size and all, it is okay. But if you have any symptoms where it affects your cycles, it causes excruciating pain, and you know, it increases in size, it is really huge that it is palpable for abdomen. Or sometimes these cysts have tendency to undergo torsion. That is, they're connected to a peduncle and that can twist. Mm-hmm. If they twist, no, it the blood supply to your ovary gets completely stopped. So that is an emergency that the patient presents with pain abdomen. So in such cases, you need to rush immediately. Otherwise, it's okay.
Thank you, doctor. Then the next question is, what can be the reason for vagina infection and swelling after periods? And what can be the solution? Is this any risk as someone has got it for two time infection after her periods?
I told earlier, right, it is based on what sanitary napkins also you use. You can switch over shun pads to menstrual cups. They have lesser chances of causing infection and discharge. Frequently, please wash locally. And, you know, don't keep your sanitary napkin for a long time. That has chances of causing infection. Because the plastics, as I said, they get absorbed in the vagina and very close to the skin around, right? So you have high chances of, you know, getting infected. So please maintain a very good personal genital hygiene. That is the answer. People who are diabetic are also very prone to, you know, vaginal infections and vaginal discharge. It is because of diabetes that this happens. If they're more prone to infections, basically, because their immunity is low. So yeah, if such things happen, like I've mentioned before, when to rush to the doctor, when the color of the discharge changes and it is in excess and all that, then you can come over.
Thank you, doctor, for this. So next question is, someone is like aged 59 or 60 and still getting regular periods. Is it necessary to take medicine to stop periods at this age or is it natural?
These days, the age of menopause has, you know, reduced, like people in their 40s and all, they attain menopause. 59 to 60 is quite, you know, a late age for somebody to have menstruation. Mm-hmm. But this used to happen in olden days, wherein if we ask our grandmothers or great grandmothers as to when they attained menopause, they would mention an age group above 55. Mm-hmm. But above 55, if she's menstruating, suppose she has had a period of amenorrhea, that means if she has not bled for a period of 6 months, mm-hmm. and after 6 months to 1 year or maybe 2 years, and after that she's having cycles, then this might be something called postmenopausal bleeding. Okay, mm-hmm. So it depends if she has had a pre-menstruating period of no menses at all. If she has had no menses for a period of 6 months to 1 year or 2 years, and after that if she's bleeding, then she really needs to get a pap smear, get some local in tests done.
Thank you, Roscoe. So this question is what are the symptoms of menopause and what can be the reason of suffering from migraine during periods?
Okay, coming to menopause, it's hot flushes, not having your regular cycles, getting irritated for no reason. All these are because of estrogen is very important for a woman when it is in right amounts in the body. So it makes your skin glow, and then it it always keeps the temperature of the body normal, and it is very good for your bones. So during menopause, what happens is the hormones, they come down. So when such things happen, you get joint pains, knee pain, backache, elbow ache, and all. You get multiple joint pains, multiple problems, and then their skin starts looking bad. The skin starts to sag and they get irritated. They have hot flushes. All these are very common. All this is pretty okay. If you want help for this, then post-menopause, hormone replacement therapy is the answer. So based on their age and based on certain things, we supplement hormones so that they still remain strong.
Thank you, doctor. And there was this question, what if someone has a dry vagina and how can they cope up with it or do something about it?
Yeah, so like I said, using soap is not indicated. Using soap changes the pH. Don't do anything that would change the pH of your vagina. That causes dry vagina and that can attract more infections. Mm-hmm. So just maintaining good personal hygiene is the answer. That's it. The vaginal pH must be acidic. Don't use anything else.
So this question is, are condoms just uses contraceptives or can be used for safe sex as well?
It is the only method by which someone can protect themselves from, getting a sexually transmitted disease. It is the one and only method. So it is not just for contraception. And there are many other things available for contraception. But, barrier method is the only method which protects someone from getting a sexually transmitted disease. So that has to be kept in mind.
Okay, so this is the question we got when we circulated the form, and it is like, is there any direct connection of sex with cyber psychology of cyber feminists?
I didn't get you.
It just said that, is there any direct connection of sex with cyber psychology of cyber feminists? There are people who on the internet who give some rape threats or girls receive some unsolicited pictures on their social media profiles. Mm-hmm. So is there a connection of the sexual, they can be classified as cyber criminals. So is there a connection?
Mm-hmm. So there are young people who are very curious and they want to experiment with their body. They want, and the thing is, sex education in India is still considered as a taboo in some parts. It is still not promoted as well as in other countries. This starts from the fourth or fifth grade, where they are educated about their body, about their private parts. They're told what is good for you, what is bad for you, what you need to do, what you don't have to do. So now coming to our country, since families also don't openly talk about it, So they don't know much about it. So they tend to divert their attention towards social media to get, more information about these things. So, before, please think before doing anything or before getting into things that will, you know, land you into trouble. Please don't send your pictures or anything to strangers. No, no.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so that was the question we got when we circulated.
I think girls just need to be advised. They just need a friendly person, a friend or a cousin or a relative who can just talk them into good things. That's it.
So the next question is, how to manage orgasmic headaches?
I didn't get you. How to manage
orgasmic headaches? That is, someone has asked on the chat.
Okay. I don't have a specific answer, since this is not a disease or something, or, you know, it does not have a treatment. Just don't be a pervert, just be normal.
So the next question is, what can be done to improve basic education to girls and boys at school levels, and are there any recommended online courses for the same?
Yeah, there are. Like I said, you know, in other countries, they promote this education from fourth or fifth grade. But in our country, it's still not, not all parts of it are included in the syllabus. Mm-hmm. So having, you know, online programs or having classes, having your friends or having gynecologists and psychiatrists talk about it to women, to girls who have just attained menarche, education should always start from in the premenarchal period or when they've just attained menarche, so that they know what is going on, so that they can, you know, it is very confusing. It is really very confusing for a young girl. She doesn't know what's going on. She doesn't know why she has to go through this much pain. She doesn't know why she has to lose this much blood. It is sad. It is really sad. So I think we should have more of, you know, it should be included in the syllabus, and you should have very approachable people to talk to about such things and to make them feel that it is okay. So I think a psychiatrist and a gynecologist can work together to, you know, educate them.
So there's this next question. I'm 60. I got an ovarian cyst, 3 and 3 fibroids, removed at 45. And now when I exercise, the operated area hurts and feels heavy. And what can be done to avoid it?
Yeah, so any sort of surgery is stress on the body. So it is okay to have pain. Coming to exercise after a certain age, heavy weights or doing exercises that you are doing when you are 45, doing them at 60, they are not advised. Just if you can manage doing your day-to-day activities at this age, and if you can manage going for a long walk and coming back, that is okay. And heavy exertion is not advised. This is not just for those who have had any cyst removed or who have had their uterus removed. For anyone who has had a regular abdominal surgery, exerting yourself too much is not advised.
Okay, thank you, doctor. What should be the post cesarean delivery precautions?
Okay, coming to this, good diet, regular food that we consume, you have to add 500 calories. You have to consume more than what you've been consuming during pregnancy, because what you eat goes to the baby. So be very judicious in that, and take the vaccine. Can you just repeat your question?
Just some post cesarean delivery precautions.
Yeah. Don't lift heavy weights at all, because it takes about 3 months for a woman to, you know, completely come back to that. Not even completely, about 80%. It takes about 3 months for you to come back to that pre-pregnant state. So it takes a lot of time for the body to adjust. So don't overexert. Don't, you know, lift heavy weights. Don't eat what is not, don't eat heavy foods. Eat normal food. And also have a very healthy environment around yourself. And, you know, during pregnancy, women are used to taking good rest and being pampered. And, you know, suddenly they look at themselves after delivery and they're like, a working woman. It affects a working woman a lot. Like, she's being in that stagnant phase. don't overexert. It is okay to not do anything. It is just don't overwork yourself. Just don't overburden yourself with work. Okay, you have to take care of the baby. You have to take care of work. You have to cook. There is no need to, you know, meet a lot of needs. You have to exert yourself in very graded amounts. Like start with, you know, little exertion in the beginning. And then for first 1 week, it is not advised to, you know, do any much of, you know, exertion. They can do their daily activities. They can walk around. The more you walk, the better it is. But don't overexert yourself. Just, you know, walk around the house. Just feed the baby. Just have a happy environment. And there is something called postpartum depression that I have seen that has become quite common these days.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so make sure that there is a healthy environment in the house for the woman and the baby, because if postpartum depression is not diagnosed and treated at the right time, it can have horrible effects on the family, on the women, on the baby. The baby might have to be separated from the mother. It can lead to postpartum psychosis also, where the woman tends to harm her own child. So that is very unhealthy. So coming to symptoms, you might, you know, crying for no reason, and then not feeling okay in spite of having your loved ones around, sleeping too much or not being able to sleep at all, not being able to eat properly, and over caring for your baby or not caring at all is a very important symptom. So all these things, it's pretty okay to feel that way. It's pretty okay to not be able to work. It's pretty okay to not have that, you know, especially for a working woman, it's very difficult. So if you're facing such things, please get help ASAP. Please talk to your family, talk to your partner about it, talk to your psychiatrist about it or psychologist about it. And they do something known as cognitive behavioral therapy, psychotherapy sessions, where they ask you to focus on the positive sides of life. Okay, pregnancy has caused these many changes in your body. You have a baby that cries all night and doesn't let you sleep. It has disrupted your work life. It has disrupted your social life. But look at the brighter side. You have something that is going to last your entire life. You have made something that is so beautiful. So psychotherapy basically focuses on these positive aspects of life, of the outcomes of pregnancy. So focus on those things. But if all these things do not work at all, then antidepressants is the answer. But make sure it does not reach that level.
Thank you, doctor. This was much needed. So next question is like, is it necessary to take medicine for postmenopausal mental disturbance and sometimes women feeling depressed?
It is not compulsory. But yeah, like I said, if it completely disrupts your, daily routine, counseling sessions do work. Estrogen is a wonder hormone that does a lot of beautiful things to your body. Estrogen, progesterone, FSH, they do a lot of beautiful things. They make the woman look beautiful. They give them that confidence. So when it decreases during the postmenopausal period, it is pretty normal to feel that it is pretty normal to lose your confidence. It is pretty okay. It is quite common. So please make sure that you see a gynecologist or a psychiatrist or a psychologist. Make sure that you get help as soon as possible. I think counseling sessions would work to some extent. I don't think it is necessary or a woman must and should indulge into antidepressants because they have a lot of side effects. So
thank you, doctor. So this is a question, like, since many hospitals are now infected with COVID, how can it be ensured that the delivery is in a safe environment? This was like, especially during the second wave, when the amount of cases were
low. Yeah. So the infection is, okay, I agree that the hospital is a high-risk zone, but the infection is not just confined to the hospital. It is everywhere. It is pretty much everywhere. So the only thing I can advise a pregnant woman is don't go out as soon as, I mean, don't go out. Just double mask and gloves is the answer, and vaccine is the answer. That's it. And when we receive a pregnant woman in labor at the hospital, we take utmost precaution to make sure she's okay, to make sure she's safe. We are all in PPEs if she's COVID positive. If not, we have, I mean, every hospital has a separate ward. So that is okay. But as long as you're in that environment, double mask, vaccine, and gloves should do.
Thank you, doctor. Should there be, since the government has now actually approved the vaccination for pregnant women, but this was a question which was going before, like, should there be a, for someone who's actually planning a child and not yet got pregnant, so there should there be a difference between them getting vaccinated and planning their child, a time difference?
Okay, yeah. Good you asked this. There, I think I've had at least 30 to 40 people asking the same question in the past 1 month, I think. Very good question. The vaccine does not have anything to do with your fertility cycle. It does not have anything to do with it. If a woman is planning to conceive, or, you know, if she's already, if she's having fertility issues and she's already on treatment, it could be medical, or if she's undergone any surgical treatment, or if she's under any artificial reproductive techniques, there are multiple, IVF and all that, take the vaccine at the earliest, and you can, you know, go ahead with conception immediately after taking the vaccine. There is no gap as such. There is all these are just misconceptions. No, it has nothing to do with your fertility or the treatment that you're taking.
Thank you, doctor. So, doctor, this is a question which I had. A lot of myths go around that sexually transmitted diseases are common with people who are homosexual. Is that a myth or is that a fact? And what are your thoughts?
It's true.
So, what are the steps which one can take to prevent that?
Yeah, so like I said, barrier is the answer to this question. And coming to male to male homosexual has the highest chances of sexually transmitted disease. So using the barrier is the only answer to this. And getting tested regularly, you know, people who indulge in activities with multiple partners, getting tested is very important for themselves so that they can get treatment at the earliest, and for their partner it is essential. So
thank you, doctor, for your very disinformative session. We have received a ton of comments from the chat, and someone has said that you're very confident and very knowledgeable in your field, and thank you for providing this fantastic session. A lot of questions we asked are like a taboo in presently when we in India, and there was a lot of inhibition of people even asking openly on chat, so they have personally messaged, but thank you for answering them, and thank you, Dr. Mehta, a lot.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta. It was a very insightful session. I think we got a lot of questions answered that were important and not discussed. Thank you all for joining. We leave with a prayer for, we wish good health for everyone. Thank you. Sarve bhavantu sukhina, sarve santu niramaya, sarve padrani pashyantu ma kashchit dukham. Thank you everyone for joining. We'll see you next weekend with a new doctor and with a new session. Thank you so much.